It's game-changing, but it's also maybe not what everyone was expecting, and I need to explain what all of this means. My A380 arrived the same day as my Stream Deck, so instead of playing handheld games in a lovely portable fashion, I've been spending the past few weeks running encoder analysis after encoder analysis like a mad scientist. And for that, we need a cool catchphrase. We need this graphics card to go beyond. Nope, can't say that one. It needs to boldly go where nope, can't say that one either. Wait, I think it had a catchphrase on the box. We need to venture into the un- I don't think I can say that either. Hold on, I gotta clear this with my agent. Hang on.
Addy, what's up?
Hey, did you see the thing I sent you? I need to know if I can say this in the video.
See what thing?
I sent you a screenshot, the box. It's the frozen thing. I don't understand why they put this here.
All right, let me make some calls. Okay, it's all taken care of.
You got them to, you got Disney's lawyers to approve the quote?
Disney? No. They changed the box.
What the? Let's venture into the unknow. We're gonna go and unknow some things. If you haven't been keeping up, AV1 is a new ecosystem of media technology designed to keep file size requirements small while being high quality enough for the needs of modern video streaming and image-heavy websites. The entire point is to keep it open source and royalty free, meaning that it's cheap and easy to implement without having to pay the exorbitant licensing fees that have seemingly made H.265 and the new upcoming H.266 dead on arrival for most consumer uses. AV1 is supported by an organization called the Alliance for Open Media, which nearly every big name you can think of is involved in. Samsung, Vimeo, Microsoft, Netflix, Mozilla, AMD, NVIDIA, Intel, and ARM, Google, Facebook, Cisco, Amazon, Hulu, Videoland, Adobe, and hell, even Apple is involved in AOM. Basically, everyone involved in streaming media in some capacity wants cheaper, more open, and higher quality tech to work with, which is no real surprise, though some of the company's predispositions for an absolutely and awfully anti-consumer DRM in the past when it comes to web streaming has me a bit concerned there, but we'll see how that unfolds. Our main focus here is on the video codec, which Twitch has actually been pursuing a roadmap to introduce AV1 streaming on its platform for years to allow for higher frame rate and higher resolution streaming without higher bandwidth requirements. But AV1 also has tools for metadata and even image formats, which could replace the .heif format, such as what's used in iPhones and even the .webp that you see on web pages now. The only limiting factor right now seems to be the actual protocol for streaming AV1 video, as RTMP doesn't work for it. I've covered decoding AV1 in depth all over the channel in the past few years. I'll have a playlist link below if you want to catch up. Hardware decoders were added in the NVIDIA 3000 series GPUs, AMD RX 6000 series GPUs, and NVIDIA's most recent round of iGPUs. Plus, tons of little mobile devices, TVs, and even game consoles going back to the PS4 Pro can play AV1 video now. And if hardware decoders aren't available, it's honestly fine to decode on the CPU as long as you're not watching 8K 60fps or something ridiculous. It was also recently shown that Netflix utilizes a very cool feature of AV1, of which there are probably tons, we just haven't discovered them all yet, called grain synthesis, which allows the encoder to analyze film grain, remove it to compress the video, and then bring it back during decoding the video. This is something that helps preserve quality while also still preserving the original artist's intentions, and I really hope that YouTube's pipeline will use this feature as well, because currently film grain on YouTube videos doesn't work. AV1 videos are everywhere on YouTube now as well, previously reserved for only high traffic videos, and a few ones at that. Ever since ramping up their hush-hush AV1 encoding hardware in their data centers, based on spot checking, I'd wager more than half of the videos that I watch on a daily basis play back in AV1 for me, which is pretty wild. You just have to tell YouTube that you prefer it in the playback settings on your YouTube settings on the computer. AV1 files also process incredibly quickly if you upload in the codec as well, which is pretty neat. The only downside to AV1, as is always the case with new high-quality video encoders, including when H.264 was introduced after everyone just got caught up on encoding MPEG-2 at the time, at reasonable speeds, is that it is far slower to encode. Real-time 1080p60 encoding wasn't even possible until just recently, but it's improving at a rapid pace. It seems like AV1 development is moving far, far more quickly than any other previous codec that has, you know, fully taken over, which is pretty wild given that we had H.264 dominating for like what, 15 years or more now? But it's improving as it goes. I demoed the CPU AV1 encoders that OBS introduced in a past update, and they were tough to encode, but the results were promising. The next step is, of course, GPU encoders. Encoding video on your graphics card has taken over independent content creator industries, allowing much higher quality and higher performance to be had while streaming or making videos without needing to reach for crazy CPUs like Threadrippers. NVIDIA was the first to really do this super well. AMD is slowly catching up, as I covered in the last video, and Intel's iGPU-based encoder with their new CPUs is now outperforming everyone with H.264. But with their debut of their first dedicated graphics card in over 24 years, they launched with the first consumer hardware AV1 encoder on board too. Let's see how it stacks up. Yes, it's graph time. I'm getting better. Before we get to all the nerdy data, check this out. I spent way too long on this. The new backing track album is legit. We now have a trio of synth rock albums for those of you who have been requesting it for over a year now. We have a lot of juicy synth goodness for you. Go stream it, use it in your videos. It's in this video. Enjoy. I don't know how to say this, but holy balls, CPU encoding is just pointless now. These results are incredible, but you'd be forgiven for looking at specific samples and not being impressed at first. Let's walk through the graphs. Be patient, as the results at play here have huge implications for the future. These graphs show each of the GPU encoder's best results for my last video about the AMF encoder update with updated comparisons versus X264 on the very slow CPU usage preset, the CPU SVT AV1 encoder, and Intel's GPU AV1 encoder. I chose very slow for X264 here because it's a kind of unobtainium benchmark of dream quality for many, and it's near impossible to run in real time due to the specific options that it uses. Placebo is the only step beyond it for X264, and it definitely can't be run real time, and sometimes actually scores marginally lower than very slow in this testing anyway. The data is measured using Netflix's VMAF quality analysis framework. I detailed it in the previous video, but basically it compares your samples to a completely uncompressed lossless sample of video and measures how a viewer would perceive the quality difference on a scale of 0 to 100, with 0 being just unwatchable and 100 being a pixel perfect match. I tested a variety of games at 3 different bit rates, 3.5 megabits per second, 6 megabits per second, and 8 megabits per second, to evaluate the scenarios of common bitrate limited game streaming. I'm only showing the FPS genre here as it best illustrates the differences in encoders, and I still have a massive amount of data to drop later in the year, so I'd rather just get you useful data now than spending extra weeks to just back up what I've already discovered here. I didn't go lower than 3.5 megabits per second because 1080p shouldn't be used at that low of a bitrate, at least with not with the traditional H.264 encoding, and I didn't go higher than 8 because Twitch doesn't support that, and the differences become less important as you go higher in bitrate anyway, and YouTube, which does support higher bitrates, re-encodes your streams, so the differences matter even less over there. As a refresher, AMD's AMF encoder received some minor updates recently, which you, the user, can't actually use yet, but is still in last place for overall quality among H.264 encoders that we've tested. NVIDIA NVENC performs about 2-5% better, depending on bitrate, than AMF, but Intel's QuickSync H.264 encoder on the 12th generation CPUs outperforms both by a fair bit, which was quite surprising. Well, at 6 and 8 megabits per second, X.264 very slow still outperforms all of these GPU H.264 encoders a fair bit. Not enough to get stuck down an expensive rabbit hole trying to achieve it, only to realize that you can't encode it in real time, but still a decent quality bump regardless. In the low bitrate 3.5 megabits per second scenarios, X.264 very slow really shines by squeezing out the best quality out of every bit. But let's add AV1 to the mix. Here's Intel's GPU AV1 encoder. At 6 and 8 megabits per second, it regularly trades blows with X.264 very slow in terms of quality, which is impressive enough for a GPU video encoder. This doesn't normally happen, but it isn't that big of a leap in quality. It's still an improvement at these higher bit rates, but it would be understandable if you weren't all that impressed. That's kind of what I meant at the beginning. If you just look at this, you're going to maybe be like, yeah, it's good, but okay. But let's zoom out and include 3.5 megabits per second. Holy freaking balls, Batman. At 1080p 60 and only 3.5 megabits per second, a bitrate that is typically a blocky mess in H.264 on most encoders, Intel's AV1 encoder just runs away with the ball here, blowing everything out of the water. These scores are insane. It gets even more wild when you look more closely and see that the Intel AV1 at 3.5 megabits per second looks better than most GPU H.264 encoders do at 6 megabits per second. So given QuickSync isn't as popular for streams as NVENC or AMF right now, effectively, this little GPU produces better quality streams than the majority of streams on Twitch at nearly half of the bitrate. I cannot overstate how remarkable this is. And if you're streaming at 8 megabits per second, it's lower than half of the bitrate. You, the streamer, could save tons on bandwidth or just pump out better quality. The viewer could save on bandwidth. The whole mobile viewers can't watch high bitrate Twitch streams thing, which I don't even know if really is an issue, but it would be a complete non-issue if you can still have decent quality at low bitrates. It would save Twitch and Amazon money at scale in terms of, you know, bandwidth and throughput. Plus, you could upload much, much smaller videos to YouTube without sacrificing quality. You know, if you're have slow internet speeds. But actually, you can do that right now. If all goes well, this video itself will be uploaded in AV1 as well. This is unbelievable. And it's just the tip of the iceberg. If I slot on the CPU-only SVT AV1 encoder, things get weirder. So SVT AV1 has different presets, much like X264's CPU usage presets, like slow, medium, and so on. These are numbered, where the smaller number is harder to run, but higher quality. In my previous testing with this encoder in OBS, most CPUs would realistically only be able to run preset 7 or higher. So here's 7 and 8 added to the graph, presets that would still be pretty tough to run, but theoretically feasible and not unfair to compare against X264 very slow in terms of realistic uses. Both of these are pretty marginal from each other, 7 and 8, but still a big leap above X264 and very slow, and Intel's AV1 encoder at 6 and 8 megabits per second, and then a massive jump over everything else at 3.5 megabits per second. Much like how X264 very slow is a leap over GPU encoders despite still running H.264 as a codec the same as the others, there will always be differences between the best of what an encoder can offer when developed for CPU encoding and to not run in real time, and what GPU real-time encoders can actually do. But consider this context here. This is the first generation of a GPU AV1 encoder. I showed in my big 2020 encoder analysis roundup just how much some GPU H.264 encoders were able to improve in hardware generations. And last video, we talked about how software changes can add some minor quality improvements too. This is just the beginning, and this is only literally the first GPU to have AV1 encoding support at all. It's theoretically possible that NVIDIA, or maybe AMD, though I have less faith there, all things considered, will have higher quality output from their AV1 encoder on the RTX 4000 GPUs, whenever they finally decide to release those cards. So as impressive as these results are, it's only going to get better and better, and it's already in such a good starting place. Every time I do one of these encoder analysis videos, I get asked for my raw samples for you to pixel peep yourself, since YouTube compression kind of messes with it and all, but that's super expensive. Like, there's 50 plus gigs of samples that I'm uploading for you all here, and it's tedious to set up, so I only make it available exclusively for my Nebula subscribers. Nebula is a creator-owned video streaming site where my videos are higher quality, ad-free, and I provide lots of exclusive content or cool downloads like this that you don't want to miss out on. I have all the video samples and raw data from VMAF analysis available exclusively over there if you want to get downloading. To sign up for Nebula, the best way is with our bundle with CuriosityStream. That's another great video site with tons of documentaries and edutainment content that I watch on a regular basis, and the bundle gets you both sites for just $14.79 for a year of great content. Nebula is included for free with that, so less than $15 per year for a year of awesome content, exclusive content from myself and many other awesome creators over on Nebula, such as Low Spec Gamer, Thomas Frank, Legal Eagle, yeah, lots of awesome people over there, Renee Ritchie. Sign up for the best deal in streaming and support the hardcore testing and, you know, documentation that I provide here like this at curiositystream.com/epos. I really hope Twitch starts experimenting with AV1 source streams being made available soon, since they've been working on it for so long, and that YouTube continues to ramp up the AV1 availability for videos. The future for AV1 video is bright. I hate feeling like I'm just puffing hot air for a new product or something, and the reality is that you probably won't be able to get your hands on an A380 anytime soon, but when they do drop, their low price and low power draw plus the encoder will make it just an incredible streaming PC GPU in a way that NVIDIA and AMD just cannot compete with right now. But this encoder, it's just phenomenal, especially because the card does still have Intel's QuickSync H264 and HEVC encoders on board too. It's not just limited to AV1, of course. I'm not sure why these new GPUs these days aren't implementing hardware VP9 encoders from any of the three companies. Like, that should be a thing by now, but AV1 is about to make that a non-issue, so hey, whatever. Based on the limited testing that I've been able to do, which has been very limited due to some issues, the A380's H264 encoder seems to be on par with the 12900K's QuickSync, which I tested in the previous video and have showed on the graphs here. I would imagine that it's literally the same capabilities, but due to some handbrake issues right now that we're working on getting resolved, I can't get full data on it. Hopefully it'll be fixed within the next couple weeks, as I'd also like to see if hyperencode, the ability to have both the dedicated GPU and the iGPU encoding alternating frames or groups of frames to speed up encode time, whether or not that has an impact on quality too. There's a lot to cover with this little GPU. I still want to take it on an in-depth look at SmoothSync, their screen tearing hider. I want to see how it plays in a system with another GPU, and I want to, you know, test encoding speed and all of that. This is just the beginning of my content here. Plus, on the AV1 side, I just want to see how the still image codec compares to the standard JPEG and now WebP compression as well. Comment below if you want to see that. Join us on Discord and, you know, to chat about this or to get help with your stream. Otherwise, I'm your stream professor, and remember, be kind, rewind.